When I gave the date of my birth, Ken was just telling me that some were trying to figure out how old I am. You see, had I known you were good mathematicians, I might not have given that. Amen? Well, how good and how pleasant it is to dwell in the presence of the Lord. And I'm glad I'm here this morning, and I'm glad wife could come with me. And we cannot do anything in the sense of performing and the operation of spiritual gifts of ourselves. I was just telling one brother about Brother F.E. Ward. We call him Few. Maybe all of you do too who know him, because his initials are F.E.W. And Ward Chandler, friend of ours who received the Holy Ghost in our church, and a close friend to F.E. Ward. And so Chandler's had moved to California, and F.E. Ward went out to visit with him, and he met him at the airport. And so on the way home, Brother Chandler would keep touching him on the knee and say, "Come on, Few, come on, give us some of this prophecy." After a while, Few said, "Listen, Brother Chandler, you can't turn this on and off like a spigot." So, amen. You just can't turn this on and off at will. Amen. It's something that comes at the will of the Spirit, and at the will of the Spirit only, if it's true. Now, do not think that a human being can't get up and put on something that is so near like the true, until it takes a very, very close observer, and that is one who has spiritual understanding, to mark out the difference. And this is what I want to do our best to get over to use the best we can after 38 years of experience in the ministry. How to detect the difference in a human spirit and even sometimes a human mind. And I do think there's a difference. And a human mind giving out something that is not a true operation of the Spirit. But I'll tell you another good point. If you will trust in God, rely on Him only, you'll never give out anything that's of self or of the human spirit. Now, the first thing is the carnal mind is not subject to the laws of God, neither indeed can be. And the human spirit is. Who knoweth the things of a man save the spirit of man that is in him? A human spirit can search out. And fact of the business, the world has the human spirit up in a bracket that they are challenging even the spirit-filled ministry of their operations in these days, because they and their high bracket of ESP and other spiritual workings, spiritualism and all of that, I want to tell you they're doing things that are outstanding. And they did it in the old Bible. The spiritualist, the witch and all of those, necromancers and all of these did things back there that was tremendous and high. And if they did not stay with the Word of God as Moses had given it to them, they would miss the mark, because they would think that this of the witch and all was just as good and just the same as that which was of God. Well, all of these things are what we're wanting to get over. So it is written in the Bible, when you stand in the house of the Lord, to lift your hands and praise the Lord. Let's do it. Everyone standing and just praising the Lord together. And Lord, we lift our hands, we thank you, we praise you, we worship you. We're so glad that we know that you're here this morning and that we're all here together. And we all have one purpose in mind, and that's to glorify Jesus Christ. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah to Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, and you may be seated. Okay. Now, we did bring a few books this morning. And I want to just mention that to you. Volume number one and volume number two. This one is Entering the Spiritual House, and this one are the three gifts of revelation. There are the three revelation gifts, which are word of wisdom, word of knowledge, discerning of spirit. And these are 95-cent books, but we're selling them to you, letting you have them at just almost 40% off. In order to get it as close as I could, you pay 60 cents a piece. And so we have about 22 or 3 left here of each. And you just come and get them. Maybe somebody will volunteer to take the money in for a share before the class is over. If you do, we'll appreciate it, because we both will be busy. Now, I'm very, very happy to have wife with me this morning. We minister together. I told you that yesterday. Many of you know that already. We minister together, and whatever the Lord does this morning, we're going to do our best to follow. Hallelujah.
Praise the Lord. Thank you. It's a privilege to be with you this morning. Praise the Lord. I count myself happy to be here, because I feel the real presence of the Lord here. Glory to
Glory.
God. When I walked into the building and began meeting you folks, shaking your hands and seeing the love of God on your faces, my heart just began to joy and rejoice in the spirit of the Komoliata, the Lord, the Spikomoliata, the Spirit of the Lord. Now you can see how I'm feeling the Spirit of the Lord. Praise the Lord. You know, when you work in the Spirit, or when you get among people who love the Lord, and you're in the midst, in the midst of them, you kabada. You feel the Spirit so greatly and so strongly, and you can hardly, well, if you speak, you just want to go into the Spirit. Praise the Lord. But that's why we came, is for the Lord to have His way. We do not have any cut or planned program. I can't work like that, neither can my husband. We have to work in the Spirit. Praise the Lord. But after all, we don't know the mind of the Spirit, and we do not know your hearts, but He knows your hearts, because He has said so in the Word. So it makes my heart to rejoice when I see you and see that you have a longing in your heart to know the will of God and how to perform in the Spirit of the Lord. So since you have entered into the spiritual house and the Spirit is in you, we know that God has a lot of great things in His storehouse. And the Word of God is the key for all those goodies He has up there. And we want to open a brand new chest today and just reach in and gather something that we've never had before. We have never known before, that it may find a lodging place in our hearts to be used for His glory, and there will be a time that it's needed. Praise
amen
the Lord.
And amen.
So it truly is a privilege to be here. God bless you. Great is the Lord, and greatly to be praised. Glory to His wonderful name. I love Him so much. He's sweeter than life to me. God bless. Komora anda. Let's just begin with a bond and with the resahandele ki of a glockahande and a hallelujah. For my soul is a man a ke among kuri my fisto.
Let's just begin with a bond together in the Spirit, as you give unto me praises and thanksgiving. For my soul is made glad when you express your full heart to me. Let's lift our hands and thank Him again. And Lord, how we do thank and praise you. How we do thank you and praise you. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Glory. Well, you know, there the Spirit speaking in the first person of Christ or God. Of course, that's the only way He ever speaks. He does not speak of Himself, you know. Jesus said He'll not speak of Himself, He'll speak of me. But, you know, He said He had a soul, didn't He? Well, if you want to confirm it in the Word, just go to the 42nd chapter of Isaiah, and you can read it. How much do I have to read? 2 verses. Amen, to get the fullness of it. Then many other places where the Lord refers to His own soul, to His own spirit, to His own mouth, to His own heart, to His own eyes, everything. Hallelujah. Somebody said God has no form. Well, in the sense of the Father and the Son, He has a form. And we have one that's a duplicate. have the same similitude. I don't want to get off on that subject. I might get too far in. Can't pull out. Amen. But here is something, let's get for good. The 12th verse of the 14th chapter of 1 Corinthians reads, "Even so ye, for as much as ye are zealous of spiritual," and again that little word gifts furnished, but if you'll put workings there or some other good word like that, it's better. Because he's not talking about our just begging and hunting and pleading for spiritual gifts. And you can pray and you can fast and you can shout and you can run and you can jump and you can do everything under the sun that you know to do, trying to win a spiritual gift, and it will profit you nothing. Amen. Wife might give a testimony in these 2 days where she got one of the most outstanding and one of the best lessons in this field I've nearly ever heard. I'll not try to give it. It's hard to give another person's testimony who had an experience through the Spirit. Now I'm going to reread, and I'll put workings where gifts, where that little word gifts was furnished there. "Even so ye, forasmuch as ye are zealous of spiritual workings, seek that you might excel, that you may excel to the edifying of the church." What I would like to say right here is this. You and I can become better vessels to the Lord as we go along by seeking or desiring to excel. Be the very best that we can. You know how the Apostle Paul wrote to Timothy, admonishing him of things to do if he wanted to be a good minister of Jesus Christ. So there are a lot of things that we must do and that we can do that will make us better ministers of Jesus Christ. And I'll tell you one of them that's a mighty good thing for us all to do, and do not let money matters get hold of us to the degree that we are depending upon some avenue, channel, or means of getting money. If you're called to the ministry, chosen of God to go into the ministry, rely on him. Don't look to a human on earth. Don't try to make a friend out of some person with money. Make a friend out of Jesus Christ. Amen. When we left for the ministry, I walked off the job. I think I mentioned this yesterday morning, or a portion of it. I was assistant to the chief engineer of Sunshine Biscuit Company in Dallas, Texas, and I loved my job. I had worked up from just a little helper in the machine shop and around the plant to this point, to the office of the assistant to the chief engineer. I had my whole heart, soul, and mind in engineering, had from a little child. But when the Lord called, that we knew we were called for more than 3 years, about four, one day he separated us, and we knew it. And we said this, "Now, Lord, no man has called us into this ministry. Nobody separated us but you. And no human on earth owes us a penny. They do not owe us anything. No human is responsible for us. We're stepping out in this work because we believe that you have done this. Therefore, we are your liability, totally and completely." And I believe we have been God's liability ever since that day, as much as Habakkuk gave him praise and relied on him for himself and what he would do. You know, after he had given prophecies, and I'll tell you the prophecies that he gave was pretty rough. And at the end of the third chapter, he said, "Although the fig tree shall not blossom, neither shall fruit be in the vines. The labor of the olive shall fail, and the fields shall yield no meat. The flock shall be cut off from the fold, and there be no herd in the stalls. Yet will I rejoice in the Lord, I will joy in the God of my salvation."
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
You too can have rosta all the sampelifi hatel and deliki hatel.
Aduna gilip tu vandele, na tu tu viandele kivit, any frosto that avile kim frosto ukuleta. So come by with your festamo and listen with Ethro and hear now. Kolave sheke mikithrando ibra ande.
You can have also these things of which has been testified to. I do not give it unto one or unto another in particular or to these two just because they desired it, but that my work might go forth, and when you will rely upon me and trust in me and accept that which I do for you, then you will be rich in the values of eternal things, and you will be able to minister my word in a greater measure. But do not think that you can excel in yourself. Lord, we thank you, we praise you. Hallelujah. So you see, we can seek to excel. We can work to do better. A minister who will not really seek how they might do better, not in gathering the riches of the world of popularity with people, but how that they might do better in ministering the things of God and sticking to His Word, that minister will succeed, and all the powers of hell can't cut him loose from it, he or she. But be sure you rely absolutely on God. Another little point I'd like to get this morning is this. You know, we use this phrase a lot, our prayer language, and I'm not against that. I do not say that it's wrong. But as far as having anything that was ever directly pointed to speaking in tongues when you receive the Holy Ghost, being a prayer language, we do not, biblically. The reason we speak in tongues when the Holy Ghost comes in is because He has arrived. And He has come in. And Jesus said when He has come, He will speak. He said He will testify. And He'll do a lot of other things for us. But this speaking in tongues is an evidence that the Holy Ghost is here. He's in me. He has come into you, in your body. He's not dwelling in your heart by faith. He's in your body. Jesus dwells in our heart by faith. And Jesus does not dwell literally in our body. He's still at the right hand of God, and that's where He'll be until we see Him in the air, as far as we know biblically. So this we do. We pray in the Spirit. We sing in the Spirit. We rejoice in the Spirit. After we are filled with the Spirit, we should exercise ourselves in the Spirit every day. Every day. You say, well, I spoke in tongues when I was filled, but I haven't spoken since, maybe a year or two ago. Well, now that would be only my fault. This happened to me for something like 2 months. After I was filled with the Holy Ghost, I didn't speak in tongues, and I became very concerned about it. And I did everything I knew to do. And I did some things maybe that was just doing something. God wasn't mad at me for doing it because I was seeking Him. But I said, Lord, I want to speak in tongues, and I declared myself a little fast. No wrong in fasting. You might not better try to fast 50 days or anything like that. You might not eat any more earthly food. Amen. But I did. I declared a fast. And the second evening, there was one of the girls from the church came over. And when I came in home from work, she was there with the wife. And they had already planned a big outing that evening. Group of them were going to get together, and you know, we were going to eat and visit and fellowship. And when they told me about it, I said, I can't go. Why? I said, I'm fasting. Well, couldn't you break your fast now? I said, not until I come into speaking in tongues. I said, I'm so hungry to speak in tongues. I haven't spoken in tongues since I was filled with the Spirit. So we said, let's go pray. And this is where we did good. We went in to pray. And I got to worshiping God, and I got to crawling around on the carpet worshiping God, and a little bit I started speaking in tongues. Brother, I want to tell you, I was so glad and happy, I was ready to eat. Amen. Hallelujah. Now, this speaking in tongues brings us into a presence of God that there's no other way that I know about biblically that you can come into that absolute presence. For when we know not how to pray as we ought, the Spirit, it's written there itself, but the Spirit isn't an it. That is, the Holy Spirit isn't. And so it's Himself maketh intercession for us, you know, with groanings which cannot be uttered. And he who searcheth the heart, who is God, knoweth the mind of the Spirit, is paying no attention to this. That thing can wander all over the country while you're just praying in tongues and interceding for somebody and praying something through that's very valuable. You might bring someone even up out of the jaws of death, and you don't even know where it is, but you have a conviction in your spirit, Lord, this is touching something somewhere. There's nothing greater than praying in tongues. But I might just get down, start talking in tongues, and it might be just about as empty as any other kind. We need to be reverent about all of this. I hear people speak so lightly and so frivolously about the things of God until it scares me. I believe we should be reverent about God. Honor Him and respect Him. Never take Him lightly. I do not mean by that God does not have humor. I believe that He does. I believe you can find portions of Scripture where He has expressed it. But I'll tell you, it was not frivolity. Paul said he didn't want us talking like that, you know, things of that kind. So, now this speaking in tongues that we receive when we're filled with the Holy Ghost is not the gift of tongues as we have it over here in this 12th and 14th chapters of 1 Corinthians. This is the first time the word gift, and this is restating something that was in the first lesson here. First time that the word gift is associated with speaking in tongues is right here in the 12th chapter of 1 Corinthians. The word gift is associated with Him, the Holy Spirit. The word gift is associated with eternal life. The word gift is associated with many things from God. But here is the first time it's associated with speaking in tongues, 12th chapter of 1 Corinthians. And this kind of operation should have an interpretation. The other kind does not need an interpretation. In fact, I've never found where anyone, when they were filled with the Holy Ghost and spoke in tongues, had a biblical, bona fide proof that it was to be interpreted. You do not find it in the Bible, the three places where it is given, there was no interpretation. Someone would say, well, now look out, Brother Goodwin, what about Pentecost? No one interpreted the messages in tongues. How did those people know who were from these other nations? Because these Galileans were speaking the language of the nation where those Jews were born. Amen. I want you to know those were all Jews. There might have been a few proselytes from, in fact, it does say a few proselytes. But they were Jews from all these other nations. And when they heard a Galilean speaking that Italian, that Jew said, listen to that Galilean up there speaking Italian. I know he doesn't know Italian. That's surmising, that part. Another one over here speaking English. And someone would say, a Jew now would say, I know she doesn't know English. Those folk do not know foreign languages. And here they are speaking them all. And you know what a lot of them said? Said, this is the wonderful works of God. You know what a lot of others said? They said, this bunch drunk. Amen. So do not worry about criticism. You're going to get it. If you live for God, I mean. If you will agree with everything, wherever you go out, however a person kind of believes, go along with him, you won't get much criticism. I remember in Childress, Texas, talking with a man, and he was telling me about his preacher. And he said, you know, he's a jolly good fella. He said he doesn't mind, and he used a few pretty strong words. They was awful close to cursing if they were not. Said, why, he just says those words. He's just so friendly. I didn't say this to that man. I was quite a young pastor. I didn't say that to him right then because I didn't feel like I was quite strong enough for an argument. But I just thought to myself, yeah, there are a lot of them like that. But if they don't make a change somewhere between here and the jumping off place, they're going to jump the wrong way. I don't care if he is a preacher, who he is. You cannot take the name of the Lord God in vain or use these curse words that involves a degrading of the high morals of God and go to heaven. I believe in holiness from the top of the head to the end of the toe. But I do not think the way I part my hair or have it cut in particular has anything to do with my holiness of the heart. Now, I think anyone that's living holy will look holy. I think if we are holy in the heart, we'll look holy. Sure I do. So, now let's remember that this operation now of gifts, and that's what we're looking for this morning. I would like to give just a little testimony here concerning receiving the operation of interpretation to where the Lord has been using me ever since that day. We had desired interpretation. Wife can give you her testimony. I do not know whether it be today or tomorrow or whether she'll even give it or not, where she was actually seeking God for interpretation. And we were going along, we desired it, and we were praying that it would be. I always knew from the teaching of the Bible that the best place in anybody's local church for interpretation to come is through the leader. I just know what God has done about the leader, the overseer of the church. Acts 28 says, and take heed to yourselves and to all the church or the flock over thee which the Holy Ghost hath made you overseers to feed the church of God which he hath purchased with his own blood. I want to tell you, a pastor, a leader of a local church has a high responsibility, and they are to be respected very, very highly. And young folk, when you go out and you start pastoring, remember that your life and your teaching will train that group of people. Amen. And be sure that we do it. And when we stumble around and do something we shouldn't, get on the line real quickly and get on the line with Jesus. He is the greatest friend a human being has ever had and the most compassionate, but he will not bear with a lot of foolishness. So, here's where interpretation should come from. So, we went along. We'd been in the ministry, right, almost 10 years. And one morning in the church, someone spoke in tongues. Now, there's a lot of other things that builds in here, but I'll not go over those. Someone gave a message in tongues, and the interpretation was right in here, and out it came. I just opened my mouth and let her come. It was almost that per se. Just started talking. I didn't think up here what I was going to say. And if this gets to bothering you, spiritually just cut your head off. Be like old Brother Seymour out there in the Azusa Street Mission. They said he'd have his head in the cracker box pulpit praying, and he'd look out once in a while to see who was coming in. And he'd see some dignitary walk in with a high collar or one thus and thus. He'd say, oh God, cut his head off. He knew if he came in there trying to understand by the mind, he'd miss it. So, this interpretation came is just like that. And I gave interpretations for quite a while. I do not know how long, a month or two. And it ceased just as sudden as it came. And we went along, and wife and I talked about it. We prayed about it. I prayed about it a number of times. We both prayed about it. We talked about it. She asked me one day, said, do you think that you might have let fear take hold of you, that you are fearful? I said, I do not believe that I am. I had searched it, and every once in a while something would come to my mind and say, give that interpretation. I would say, I have nothing to give. You might as well just talk to the devil in an audible voice as well as God. I'd say, I have nothing to give. He said, you could say thus and thus. And I'd say, yes, but I wouldn't know anything else to say. I knew if I ever swung out on that, it would make a monkey out of me. I didn't do it. And I went along and I just had temptations from various angles. Get in a meeting, you know, a sectional meeting with a lot of preachers. Somebody speaking tongues, no one to give an interpretation. They'll say, you can give that. And I say, I can't. Well, you have. And all such as that he'd give. But it's all coming through here. One day, here it came, right out of here. I knew it the moment it hit my spirit. And ever since that day, I've been giving interpretation, and especially when wife and I are working together, anytime she speaks a message in tongues, the interpretation's there. And most, I think I can safely say, anytime anybody speaks a message in tongues, interpretation will be here. Now, I do not give them all. There is some ministerial ethics. And there are many things that we must not do because it would be unbecoming to another assembly. If I'd walk into your assembly, your church, and I had not been spoken to concerning it, and someone would give a message in tongues, I would not give an interpretation. I do not butt in on another minister's work. And don't you ever do it either. I can remember a number of times when we were ministering together, wife and I, personal ministry to someone, and somebody would cut in. And when they cut in, it's just like cutting the charm off I'll just use the word, the old serpent, snake. I remember when I was a little boy seeing a snake charming bird. He had that bird in his charm. And there was another bird that was flying down to break that. And that bird flew down the second time. He kind of missed it the first time. And the second time he flew between this little bird and that snake, he broke that charm. That little bird up there flew. Somebody cut in. And it'll break the spirit of it. Don't ever do it. Study ethics as well as to study the Bible and to study how to pray. Hallelujah to God. If they ask you, will you give interpretations? Take it. And if the Lord gives them to you, give them. If he doesn't, keep your peace.
This is a very sacred bundle. You must be very key thrust on the lake higher. Become believe viata. He will make it through the lake higher. The impro stuff is not trust me. But in the heart, Tilly. So come by the Ikea. Ikea for some fanule, listen to le. Some call it is say I'm brother. Ikea for so call it and day.
This is a very secret bond for you. It will save you and protect you in every matter. When you have been quickened by my spirit to act, choose your place of opportunity and give out. For when the message comes and the Spirit will quicken you, it will not come by the way of your mind, but it will come by the way of your spirit. Did I not say unto you through David that the spirit of man is the candle of the Lord, and the Lord lighteth my candle? Can you not see this and accept this and get it from my word that when I anoint you with a matter, you can act in all safety? But if you act upon your own zeal and the things of your mind, you will not be taking my message.
Now praise me, Kali Vista, and much we come to the handle for Gomba.
Now praise me, all of you people, and much will come to you even on and on out of this message. And Lord, we do. We thank you. We praise you. We worship you. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah to Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Glory to God. Hallelujah. I give all praise to the Lord and thank Him so very, very greatly for something that He has blessed me in through people, and that is through ministers. I have a number of ministers. When we enter their church, they'll ask me to come and give interpretation. You say, can you do that? Well, if a person's been chosen as a vessel to give interpretation, if they're in line, if the Spirit's going to work, He'll surely work with them.
Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah. Brother Howard Carter, as the chairman of the Assemblies of God in England, always set someone on the platform or had them on the platform to give interpretation. And he'd use a different person at different meetings, each meeting, so they could all work together. He didn't just let someone speak in tongues here and somebody over here give an interpretation. He had someone up here give interpretation so everyone could hear it. This is a good order for carrying on your service. It's a good order for carrying on your church. If you have 10 in a church, you need to, if you have working of tongues, interpretation of tongues, and prophecy, you need someone who would be at the head just as much as you need if you had 10,000 in your church. 10 people are just as important to God as a unit of 10 units, as 10,000 are important to Him as 10,000 units. Do not think that you are necessarily getting a great spiritual build-up and you're favoring God more just because you have a big church. And do not think that you're a little person, just a little preacher, insignificant just because you're pastoring a small church. If you and I will be faithful in whatever we have, I'll guarantee you, you can have that vernacular if you want to, guarantee you, I'll guarantee you that you will succeed and that your church will soon grow as quickly as you or I would get through trying to make it grow in numbers rather than in spirit. Hallelujah. Preach it now unto my people, and I will be with you. You preach and teach this that is in my word, and there is nothing that can block it. I will be with you and deliver you and will give you increase. It might not come in a day, but if you will be true to your charge, it will come in plenty of time to cause you to know that I am with you. Glory to God. Hallelujah. 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 Get another thing in interpretations. Interpretations, a sent of the Spirit of God, does not have chaff in it. What do you mean, Brother Goodwin, by chaff? I mean that is not worth anything. That is to go away with the wind. Be blown away by the wind. Now see if you recognize some interpretations, if you would count something like this to be of God or be of man. Oh, my little children, I am with you. I will be in your midst. I am going to bless you and cause your church to be the greatest church in the community, and the people from all round about will flow in to you. How much would you give for that? I wasn't giving an interpretation. I was just talking. I've heard them just like that, see? This is quite a humorous one, a preacher friend told us. He said he heard this, so I believe it's true. Someone gave an interpretation and said, My little children, if you are my little children, that's all I'll give of it.
Brother Goodwin, I believe I finished that. It's good.
Thank you. So you want to watch interpretation. Say, Lord, if I do not have interpretation of the Spirit, I don't want any kind. Amen. He'll say, well, do not be so zealous and anxious of yourself. Just wait on the Lord. That's exactly what is meant about he that waits upon the Lord. Shall renew his strength.
Yes.
He shall mount up on wings as eagles.
Yes.
He shall run and not be weary. He shall walk and not faint.
Praise
glory to God. If it isn't from the Lord and if it isn't true and straight, say, I won't have that. Maybe some voice would say to you, I'm the Lord. Are you turning me down? You say, yes, unless you show me where that'll parallel the Scripture. Men and women, study the Scripture, study the prophets. Watch their messages. You'll never see where any true prophet ever gave messages that were favorable to the human being's anxiety. You go read Jeremiah and many of them, but Jeremiah comes out so against those false prophets. And the 23rd chapter is a real good one, but all through his book. And he so identified false prophets. If you'll just watch them, they prophesied for favor. They wanted the favor of the king. You know, Micaiah got into a lot of trouble because he wouldn't prophesy to Ahab, something that favored him. All of his other prophets had been prophesying to him, go up, you'll win, and all of these things. You can get this in the 22nd chapter of 1 Kings. And so, Jehoshaphat knew there was something wrong with their prophecies. And he asked him, don't you have a prophet of the Lord around here? He said, yeah, we have one, but said, I don't like him. He said, he never says anything good about me. You and I can get to wanting something good about me until we'll miss God. Well, he sent an officer to get him out of jail. That's where he was. Brought him up there, and old Mikhail, this officer told him, said, now listen, all those other prophets are prophesying good about this king. And said, don't you be contrary. And said, you give him something good. And old Micaiah came up and he walked up and Ahab asked him the question. He said, go up, king, and prosper. He didn't tell him he would. He just told him to do it. And you need to catch that little point. Amen. And that king knew he wasn't telling him the truth. He knew that wasn't what Micaiah would give him. So he said, haven't I told you to never tell me anything but the truth from God? He said, I see Israel scattered as sheep without a shepherd. When he did, I want to tell you, Ahab flew to pieces. He said to Jehoshaphat, didn't I tell you that he wouldn't say anything good about me? He knew what that indicated, that he'd be killed and Israel would have no shepherd. So Micaiah stood there and he said, I see heaven open. And one on the throne. And all the host of heaven gathered about him. And he asked the question, who will go down and persuade Ahab to go up to Ramoth-Gilead that he might fall there? One said after this manner, another after that. And a spirit said, I'll go persuade him. He asked him, and how will you persuade him? Folk, this is a council in heaven. And a prophet is seeing it and hearing it. And how will you persuade him? He said, I'll be a lying spirit in the mouth of his prophets. You mean a lying spirit came from God? Right at the presence of God. I don't mean God sent it out of his spirit. Yes, a lying spirit came right out from the throne of God. He'd been up there and he asked God for permission and told him what he could do. And Satan appears before God every day, and he tells lies on you, and he tells lies on me. And there's one thing about it, and you can mark it down, he'll never tell the truth. And so that lying spirit, when Micaiah got to that place, Ahab told the officer, said, go lock him up. And I think there's something in there about putting him so far back, you and I might use the phrase, put him so far back you'll have to shoot beans to him with a slingshot. Now that isn't in the Bible, that last phrase, that last statement. But I said about like that. Well, did you know that if we are not careful, we get just about that anxious to do good? I remember one night having a good old friend, old boy that was filled with the Holy Ghost. He was a minister of another denomination. He was filled with the Holy Ghost in our church. Wife and I was praying for him one day. He met us there at noon hour. And he's filled. Later he got to wanting to be a prophet, and I want to tell you, he was prophesying. I had him one time for a service. He got to prophesying to our young people, and he had prophesied to the boys and the girls, teenagers, still in school. And he'd tell them, you're going to carry this message, you're going to carry it to nations. I wanted to get up right then and stuff, and I thought that wouldn't be very courteous, stop him, because I knew there was not a lick of truth in it. Brother Goodwin, how did you know there was not a lick of truth in it? Why, it was so adverse to scriptural doctrine. That's exactly how I knew. Did you know by your feelings? If you get to going by feelings, you won't ever be anything but a bundle of mistakes. Sometimes you feel good, you could jump the moon, you'd think. And another time you feel down and you say, God's dead. He hasn't touched me, and I can't get any life. So if you go by feelings, you're already whipped. You're defeated. But when you go by the Word of God and stay with it, you can't be whipped. Glory to God. Forever He has settled His Word in heaven, and He'll never change it. And He has magnified His Word above all His name. 107th Psalm 20th verse said, He sent His Word and healed them and delivered them from their destructions. Hallelujah to God. That Word, and you stay with it and watch it work. So this preacher, he is doing that around everywhere. But it wasn't long before a lot of people began to see that his prophecies were false. He'd just make them feel like, man, I'm called. And some of them would almost want to quit school and go right on out in the ministry right then. I'd just like to put this one in. You can pay me extra for this some other time. Folk, get all the education we can get. If we're sanctified by the Spirit of God, education will never hurt us. I don't care how much they teach us. That man came from a tadpole. That won't cut a figure in mine, your spirit at all. We know that nobody but somebody that's gotten so packed with frivolous things until they don't have any room for truth would believe such as that anyway. Mr. Brother Goodwin, you get awful strong. Well, the Word of God said God created man, breathed into him the breath of life, and he became a living soul. And I believe that because his image, His similitude is still in the earth and the human being, and we're built just like He was. You know, we have a teaching that we are what Adam was, and we will be what Adam is. Well, we are a result of what Adam was, and that is we're just old human. A lot of mistakes. But watch this prophecy. We are talking on these inspirational gifts this morning. They are worth more to the church than all the money in this city and county, state, or anywhere else when they are in operation correctly. Prophecy will never have anything that is petting, pleasing just to a human. For instance, I want to give someone a good prophecy. I'm trying to win them for the church. I'm really working, trying to get a member. And I give them a prophecy. Yea, thus saith the Lord, I have much for you to do. You join with this my servant, and he will place you and train you, and you will be a success, for I, the Lord, have declared it. You know how much I'd give for a prophecy like that? $5 if I could erase it out of my whole being, mind, and forget it. Folk, God doesn't work like that. If you and I don't want to surrender to God, He's not going to send prophets to us promising us good things if we'll serve Him. You know what Jesus said to a man when he came up to him? And Jesus loved him. And he asked him what he could do to inherit eternal life. Jesus told him. He said, you know how it's written. And the man quoted it to him. He said, yeah. He said, I know. He asked him, said, what is the first great commandment? And the man quoted it. He said, do this and you'll live. Well, when he got to that part, you know, sell that and give and come and follow me, take up the cross and follow me, the man just couldn't follow that. And he went away, and Jesus loved him very much, but he didn't say, come back, I can change that a little. I want to tell you what's put down in here stands pat. It won't be changed.
You see, my visto is in fallibilita. You could nearly be standing at chinkality and die. So that fambalekista you hear thrust Sunday, be you kofa nena kam, nena ne kosata. Be Kalavembo, Kuz, Don Stele, and Branda, Kaylee, Steve, Wuka, look, in the Vista. Risa Kahaya, Prasahandele Kia, and Yeshikamboni.
You see, my word now formed eternity. It is through my word and by my word that you believe by faith that there is a place where you will come, will be everlasting peace. You believe that I created all things because it is written in my word, and I said it is forever settled in heaven. There will be no change. There will be no foul-ups of the things that I have given in my word. Study to show thyself approved unto me, and I will be with you and bless you. Praise God. Hallelujah. Folks, this working is great.
You hear me say, Philly, look last in the valley of Vienna, priva Vienna, and if you can't stop, if you
go. You heard me say, lastly, look people, look straight into my word. Let your countenance reflect in my word and see yourself in the face, for these things will not fail until every jot and tittle is fulfilled. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus.
Now, you don't know this, but I'm going to tell you. Many times when the Spirit is working, I see many things in the Spirit. And lots of times when I'm speaking, I'm seeing.
That's right.
I don't notice it. Sometimes I do, sometimes I do not. Many people tell me I have gestures with my hand. I don't notice that much. You know, cola dombolista. Glory. But I've known people, have a nephew who's studying sign language, and when we were in the Bible school, they were teaching, of course, the deaf and the dumb there. And they said many gestures that while I was speaking that came out in the message that I'd made with my hands. See, I don't know all of this. But the Lord sure wanted you to have that. Because I saw as I was speaking, you turning the word. He wanted you to turn the word and to pray. Then he brought it in lastly. But I want you to see that. That's why I spoke again. And the Spirit spoke it. He wanted you to see that. He wanted you to know that. Then he wanted me to tell you this. That you must look into the word and see your reflection and pray, and you will. If we are doing something that's not right, that's
Sometimes the devil will deceive us. Why? In the Word we'll find it. Isn't that beautiful?
Amen.
The Word guides us, doesn't He? And I want to tell you that. Just many things this morning I see about you. And after we have finished here, there's some things I want to tell you. Just take a little time after we have completed.
Suppose you go on and tell it right now.
No, it'll be, I want to, that I see a couple that the Lord wants to talk to, and we'll do it after we've finished, okay? You go ahead.
And so many times the Lord will minister to individuals. But I want to call your attention to one point there. You be sure that it's God. You be sure that what you're getting through the Spirit, a message to an individual, is definitely God. Do not try to give a message to an individual because of what you think about that individual. Be sure that God is ministering and it'll stand up. Praise God forevermore. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Folk, I'll tell you, this has been a great morning to me. And to have her with me just makes it so much stronger. We work together all the time. So the Lord bless every one of you greatly as our prayer. And be with us again in the morning. But you heard what wife said about she had some things she wanted to do here even after the session is over. Praise God forever. The Lord bless everyone.